heard yesterday that one of the important aspects of Islamic History Month is to fill in the gaps. It is to try to give information that is not normally available to people. And this is something which is very important, because a historian has a body of information, and he or she chooses the information which fits their understanding or their agenda, and they put it together. And this is how you get different historical narratives. And based upon what position or how that person looks at the world, they will write the history. We started off yesterday with the statement that Christopher Columbus discovered America in 1492. Now, from his perspective, for a person from Spain, Portugal, that region, he could probably say that he was the first person of Spanish origin. We know now that there were others before, many before. But from his perspective, he was the first person to discover what he called the Indies, or India. Okay, and so they make that statement that he discovered America in 1492. So that would be what we call a Eurocentric statement. That means it's centered in Europe. The person coming out of Spain or Portugal, his projection of the world is the way you're looking at it. And that's the reason why we call it his story, right? Remember, not history. His story. It's not my story. And it's definitely not the Indians who were on the shore when Columbus came, because he probably landed on the shore and said to them in a dialect of Spanish, I discovered you. And they probably calmed him down and gave him something to drink. But the problem that happened is that his intention was to gain riches for the king and queen of Spain, Castilla and Aragon, who had just conquered the Muslim part of Al-Andalus. He wanted to gain riches and gold. And his people had been trained in high levels of what we call today counterinsurgency. They were counterinsurgency experts. They would be what you call today black ops, the Delta Force. That's who he was carrying with. And when he reached the Indies, the native people there, the Arawaks and the Caribs, they were not ready for anything like this. They did not have violence like this. And so the violence that hit the Indies and the Americas created a genocide, and then diseases that later came with the colonists actually created what some historians consider to be the biggest genocide in the history of humanity. That's a heavy statement to make, right? But historians believe there were 75 million native people living in North America, Central America, the islands of the Caribbean, and South America. And that number is down to very small number now. So it's millions. And it's civilizations that actually went down. But aside from that point, getting back to the whole thing of issue of history, right? So from his perspective, he discovered America. From the perspective of human beings, if we look at the natives there as human beings, and the Spanish are human beings from different parts of the world, Columbus was lost. And he thought he was an Indian. And he bumped into the islands and he said, "You people are Indians." And they don't know what he was talking about, because they didn't have contact with Indians. You see, so really, in reality, the proper statement should have been that Christopher Columbus was discovered in 1492. See, you see how that turned around? Because he was lost. Okay, and he could not properly describe when he went back to Spain where he had been. He didn't know. So he had to go back again. They outfitted the ships again. He went a couple times. He never set foot on land. It was his son, Ferdinand, who set foot on land in Central America. And when he reached Central America, he saw pyramids. He saw hanging gardens. He saw a calendar like the ancient Egyptians. He saw a civilization that could rival anything that they had seen before. That is the reality of what they actually found. But we don't learn this in the history books. Similarly with Muslims, there is a concerted effort that came from the time of what is known as the Crusades, right? A concerted effort to rewrite history and to try to demonize Muslims as though we are a type of evil force coming from the East, and they use the word Saracen. Saracen means Sharpi, Sharpiyun, meaning Easterner. So they use that term Saracen, right, and say, and they use the word Mahomet to describe the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Mahomet from Bahomet, which means the devil, or Iyadullah. So this is what they were saying, that Muslims are devil worshippers, right, and they conquered and destroyed and they ruined, right, everything that they came across. From our perspective, it's completely different. So what I want to show you briefly tonight is a look at this part of history from our perspective, to give some new light upon this history. For those of you who want to go deeper into this, there is a group called Al Maghrib Institute, and I teach at the history section of that, and we go much deeper at Al Maghrib Institute there. Also, we have established classes here, so inshallah this will be continuing here as well. So going back to the early part of our history, you have to remember that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions in the Arabian Peninsula, they found themselves under attack. Once they had consolidated Mecca and Medina, they were under attack, serious attack. And the biggest attack was coming from the Romans. These Romans are known as Byzantines, right? They're based in Constantinople. And so they launched an attack. The Prophet ﷺ went out to meet them at a place called Tabuk. But Allah put fear in their hearts, and they never showed. But following this, that hostility continued. And there were attacks going on the borders and whatever. So the Muslims were forced to send up troops in order to deal with the Romans, because they would not stop attacking from the north. Similarly, from the eastern side, the Sassanid dynasty of Persia, they were attacking from the east. So Muslims had to respond to them. When they responded in the north, they found that the Romans were extremely weak. Their people hated them. And so they defeated the Romans and made the intention to take back all of Roman territory in the Mediterranean. So the fighting that you see in this point, it was not to spread Islam. It was to deal with Roman oppression. And on the African continent, as we have here, a Muslim group led by Sayyidina Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anh, they entered into Egypt. And by entering into Egypt, they found that the Coptic Christians and the followers of Arius, who was a Libyan bishop, who refused to accept the Council of Nicaea in 325. They believed in one God, right? His people called Arians. So the Arians and the Coptic Christians united with the Muslims. And you'll find this also in Western history books, Orientalist history books, that these three groups fought against the Romans. Right? Because the Romans was unpopular. They had conquered the land, occupied the land. So they fought against the Romans. So this is the first entrance into North Africa. And you can see here on this map, the green part, this is the spread of Islam in the first 100 years or so. And you'll see on this green, Amr ibn al-As is entering here. Okay, and so they went right across. This is how they moved across, because the Byzantines controlled this whole area here, the whole Mediterranean. So they started to go across. Now, as they were going across, they ran into a people who were the original inhabitants of North Africa, known today as Berber people, but they call themselves Amazigh, the Amazigh people. And the Amazigh people are many different tribes and nations. Some of them live on the coast, some of them live in mountains, some of them live in the desert. They were the original people because the Sahara Desert region here, the Sahara Desert region, this region here, used to be a rainforest. But then it turned desert a couple thousand years ago. That's why if you go to Algeria and Libya, people think it's just the desert in Algeria. It's not just a desert, right? Flat desert with sand dunes. There's valleys, there's underground water, there's minerals. This is a quiet kept secret. Algeria is a really important country, right? Really important country. And that desert region used to be a rainforest. So the Amazighan people, they are, we'll call them Berbers. Although this is not really a nice word, but somehow they call themselves. Berber is what we call barbarian, right? A barbarian is not a nice word, right? It's like a really out of control kind of, you know, anyhow. We'll call them the Berber people. So the Berbers, well, started to accept Islam. And it is said that a group of them were brought to Medina. And when Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu, saw them, he cried. And they said, "Why are you crying?" He said, "Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam predicted a group of people like this would enter into Islam." He predicted these people, how they look and act and their language, right? And they became really strong proponents of the Islamic message. But some of them resisted. And there was a woman named Kahina. And she would go in the mountains with her forces, and they resisted. But the leader of Islam who was sent to go across North Africa was Uqba ibn Nafi', radiallahu anhu, great tabi'i. And he established as his base of operations a city called Qayrawan. Okay, now this is part of history that even we as Muslims, for the most part, we don't know this part. But this is a really important part of Islamic history. And it's kind of the background to Al-Andalus. You need to have this to understand what happened to Al-Andalus properly. Uqba established Qayrawan. This is a picture in Tunis, Tunisia. That's a reservoir. They dug reservoirs, and he made Qayrawan in the desert. Because if he went too close to the shore, the Romans would attack with their boats. If he went too close to the mountains, Kahina would come with her forces. And so the desert was the natural environment of Muslims at that time. Because they were riding Arabian horses. So they were natural in the desert. So he established Qayrawan as a strategic capital of Islam. So that's a very important word. The French spell it with a K, right? See that spelling there? So you might see the spelling there, but the phonetical spelling would be Qayrawan. That's a picture of a picture that I took there. I visited Qayrawan. That's a picture of a picture. You have a question about it?
I just wonder what Qayrawan means.
I don't know exactly what it means. I'm not sure, but we know that this is what Uqba, established, and they called the capital there. And it also became a seat of Islamic authority. That's Masjid Uqba ibn Nafi'. Okay, these are important places to visit, right? After you make your Hajj and Umrah and go to Masjid al-Aqsa, inshallah, right? These are the places to go. This, then, it's better to go here than Disneyland, right? Or the Eiffel Tower, right? The Tower of London, right? These are the places that we should go with our children, especially, to understand Islamic heritage. That's the Masjid al-Uqba ibn Nafi', still there. So Tunisia is a really important place to visit, right? It's a very important country. Because in this masjid, this is where the Maliki scholars, the four schools of thought, right? We generally here in Toronto, we have Shafi'i and Hanafi. Right? The Hanbalis, usually Saudi Arabia or Kuwait or whatever. But Maliki, the teachings of Imam Malik ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, he was the teacher of Imam Shafi'i. He wrote the first hadith book, Sahih hadith book, Al-Muwatta. right? He's a great leader, the great teacher of Darul Hijra, Imam Malik. Right? So his teachings took root here in this masjid. And one of the great tabi'i tabi'ins, his name is Sahnun. Sahnun put together the writings of Imam Malik, and they called it Al-Mudawwana. Al-Mudawwana Al-Kubra. So these are the fatwas, the decisions of Imam Malik, and it is a key part of Maliki fiqh. So Maliki fiqh was established here. This is the base of Maliki fiqh, Qaynawan. And for the rest of the Muslim world, it becomes the Western capital of Islam. That's your Western capital, right? Remember what I'm saying now. I'm saying West, right? Now, look at my centering, right? Middle East is east from where? From London. Far east. See the centering? Far east, far from where? If you're Chinese, is China the far east? No, it's the center of the world, right? So when you say far east, you're thinking Eurocentric. You centered your mind in Europe. When you say Middle East, middle from where? Then you say, that's how you're thinking, you know. So when I say West, I'm not Eurocentric or Afrocentric or Indocentric, I'm Mecca-centric. You see that concept? Mecca-centric. I'm centering myself in Mecca. So the west of Mecca, right, is Ethiopia, where they first went, Muhajirin, and then Egypt and across. That's why Morocco was called Al-Maghrib. That's west, right? See the centering? Why don't they say Al-Mashriq? Or Janub? South? They say no, Al-Maghrib. Because it's west of Mecca. Okay? So this was the base of the Maliki fiqh. And Islam began to spread, not through military confrontations. It was spread by trade, wandering scholars, pious people. This is basically how Islam was spread throughout that region. Arabic became the main language of not only religion, but also scholarship, business, technology. Arabic was the key language. And if you learn Arabic up until today, you can use it for a lot of things. There's a lot of things you can use it for. I didn't realize that myself, right? I entered history here in the University of Toronto, and I found that most of the books written in West Africa and North Africa before the colonial period, they're all in Arabic. So if you want to even read a history book, you have to learn Arabic. So there's a lot of things that Arabic can actually give you as you learn. But when you learn Arabic in the Maghribi sense, you have to... Jibreel, can you get Muhammad, right? See if you can get him downstairs. Oh, you hear me. Okay, this is going to have to be changed. The Maghribi script. This is the Maghribi script. That's one of their books. You got to adjust your reading. Because if you read Qaf, it's got one dot on the top. You know, that's normally Fa, right? Fa has got one dot underneath. So you're reading the Quran, and the dots underneath is a fa, right? One dot on the top is qaf. And if it goes a wide squiggle on the back with no dot, it's noon. Okay? No. Once I come to the end. Okay? Just a minute. So that was the situation in North Africa. It's spreading across Uqba ibn Nafi'a. He reached to the Atlantic, and he rode his horse right in. And he said, if I knew there was land across you, I'll take but Islam. Right? But he stopped there at the Atlantic. Okay? And, but he was a person who was, you know, a lot of energy, what you could call an initiator, right? When you have leadership, you have leaders who initiate things, and you have others who consolidate. So the initiator needs a consolidator. If you don't have a consolidator, he's running all around like a chicken with his head cut off. Someone's got to consolidate, right? Okba was initiated. He just keeps writing. Right? So Islam was there, but it was not as solid as it should be. So the Umayyad dynasty in Damascus, they sent a man, very important person to remember. His name was Musa bin Nusayr, Rahimullah. This is an important person. His father was Christian. And when the Muslim forces defeated the Romans in Syria, his father was studying to be a bishop in the Christian church. And he was captured as a prisoner of war, and he was made a servant under Khalid ibn al-Walid, who was a great general of Islam. Khalid saw how intelligent he was, and Musa fell in love with Khalid. Khalid freed him and made him his right-hand man. And so Nusayr rose in the ranks and became a general. And his son Musa then grew up with a very good education, from all different angles. And Musa was sensitive to people of other religions. His father was Christian originally. Right? So he had a different kind of thinking. He was very sensitive. So when he came to North Africa, he went to the Amazigh people, the Berbers, and he gave them education. He let them have opportunity. They rose in the ranks. They had business. See how you gain people not by swords and fighting, right? By education, opportunity, right? And then they fell in love with him and they accepted Islam in the thousands. So Musa bin Nusayr was an extremely important person. Across the ocean on this side, right? See how close it is? See how Morocco there? See how close the tip is to Spain? Right across there is what they call the Iberian Peninsula. Okay? And there was a group of people living, the main group living there were called Vandals. They were Gothic people, German people. And they had defeated the Romans. So the Romans used this word to mean a bad word. Up until today, if I said to you, Walmart was vandalized last night, do you know what I mean? That's not an Americanism, right? Canada too, right? What did I mean when I said that? Walmart was vandalized. Did it mean they painted it up and cleaned it? No, somebody robbed it, smashed the windows. Vandalization, right? That's the name of a people, right? The Vandals. So they called their land Vandalusia. And then it became known as Andalusia. And Arabic-speaking people called it Al-Andalus. Al-Andalus. That's the most... that's the strongest position where the name comes from. Okay? But the problem they faced is that the Vandals, although they believed in one God, many of them, they were being conquered again by the Roman Empire, who sent a group called Visigoths, Trinitarians, believed in three gods, right, to conquer them, and their leader's name was Roderick. And he conquered the people in the name of the Roman Church. And so they were suffering there. The Vandal people, he punished them. Also the Jewish population. You would say, what are Jewish people doing here? From the time of Nebuchadnezzar, in 560 or so BC, when Jerusalem was sacked by the Babylonians, many of the Jewish tribes fled to Spain. So they were living there from BC in the same place. It's a beautiful country. But the Trinitarians also punished them. They punished them really bad. And so they were calling out to be liberated. And they called out to Musa bin Nusayr. Help us by any means necessary. But Musa was a consolidator. And he was very cautious. He was trying to consolidate North Africa. He didn't think about going across into Europe. It wasn't known as Europe at that time. But he was not really that interested. But he thought about it. And suddenly, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the Christian leaders who controlled a little section, the tip of Morocco, it's called Ceuta. It's called Ceuta. Up until today, it's Spanish territory. Ceuta. It's right in the tip of Morocco. And they were Christians. They accepted the Muslims, Amir al-Mu'mineen, and they paid jizya tax. So they paid jizya. which is less than zakat, by the way. So they were accepted to stay as Christians and control their land as long as they paid the jizya and they supported the Muslims, no problem. Okay, but Ilian or Julian, the leader, he sent his daughter to study in Toledo. Toledo, the city of Toledo, was the educational capital. And Roderick, when he saw the daughter, who was very beautiful, he violated her, he raped her and violated her. And Ilian or Julian, he wanted revenge. So he went to Musa bin Nuzair. Musa said, "You prove to me that you're serious. Prove it." And Julian went across. And he attacked and he came back and he said, "I have boats, I'll take you across." So they sent a person named Tarifa first across, he landed. And then the second landing was a person named Tariq ibn Ziyad. And Tariq ibn Ziyad was a Berber man, a Mazagan. He could speak fluent Arabic as well. And he became the top general of Musa bin Nuzair. And he went across, and this is an actual picture of the straits going across them. And they landed on a mountain there, and they called it Jabal Tariq, right? The mountain of Tariq, right? And now you call it Gibraltar. See where the name comes from? Jabal Tariq. The mountain of Tariq becomes Gibraltar. So there's a lot of words like that in English. Roderick came with a huge army of about 100,000 men. Tariq had a small force. He called for assistance. Musa sent, some help. They had about 19,000. So it was 100,000 Visigoths versus 19,000 Muslims. 5-1. In those days, for Muslims, they said that's about even. That's how Muslims used to think, right? That's about even. Because we have malaika, right? So that's fine. Tariq went inside. It's a long story. I don't have details. Time to go into the details. But Tariq encouraged his men to go forth and liberate the people. There's a wrong report that Tariq burnt the boats. You ever heard that before?
Yes.
They said Tariq burnt the boats. That's being reviewed by Muslim historians. And it was written by Orientalists. He did not burn the boats. Why are you going to burn your boats? It's like they tried to make him into a suicide bomber or something. Why are you going to burn the boats? That's a strategic retreat. He didn't burn the boats. What he did was he encouraged them with the akhirah, right, with shahada and things, and he went forward himself, right, and he motivated his troops, and he went forward. So this is being reviewed. You'll see some scholars now changing their position. Raghib al-Sirjani from Egypt, Tariq Suwaydan from Kuwait. A number of people who are writing, they've gone through and found this is a wrong report. Okay, so Tariq was victorious. And Roderick was completely defeated, right? Even though it was 100,000. And Tariq went north. Every place he went, the people opened up their doors. Now in those days, each city was surrounded by a huge wall. And usually a moat or a khandaq. Very difficult to lay siege to a city there. But every city he went to, they opened the doors. Because he was not enslaving them. He did not force the people to become Muslim. He lowered the taxes, no taxes, like before. So they said, "This, we never had this before." So he went all the way as far as he could go north. 712, Musa came in back of him. And Musa also consolidated the places where Tariq went. Right? He consolidated. And so they continued to go north until they reached all the way north by the Pyrenees Mountains in France. The whole of what is now Spain and Portugal. They took all of it. And their intention was to go across and then conquer the rest of Europe and then meet back in Damascus. Right? If they had done that, that would have changed history, right? But the Khalifa at the time was intelligent too. He said, "Don't overextend yourself. Consolidate. Use your sense, right? Consolidate." So they consolidated the territories there. And for 40 years, the people of Al-Andalus lived in a state of peace. right? Musa and Tariq left, went back to North Africa. People were living in peace. There were emirs in the city. They had never had anything like this before. It was an amazing time for the people. But the problem was, they needed a leader. They needed a leader. Okay, because their leader was either at Beitawan or in Damascus. That's too far away. Okay, so by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a long story I don't have time to go into, but you may be familiar with a power struggle that went on in the east between the Umayyads and the Abbasids. This was a power struggle, and the Abbasids, Banu Abbas, they defeated the Umayyads, and they were killing everybody in the royal family they could find. In 755, the final Umayyad, whose name was Abdurrahman ibn Muawiyah, right, Rahimahullah. They call him the Falcon of Quraysh, Abdurrahman al-Dakhil. Right, he escaped, and he went across into North Africa. Now, what was different about him is that his mother was a Berber. His mother was Berber. The father, Quraysh, but the mother was Amazigh. So when he reached Qaydawan, they realized he is from the people of the region, right? So the scholars, the ulama of Qaydawan said, best thing to do, go to Al-Andalus. They need a leader. So he went to Al-Andalus, and he established, he ruled for 32 years. And he is a very important person. The scholars say if it was not for Abdurrahman al-Dakhil, Islam would have finished in Al-Andalus. What did he do? This is a lesson for our leaders today, right? When they take over power, right? That's the biggest problem we're having is not the revolution, it's after the revolution. He should be studied by every single leader. What did he do? The first thing he did was, he did not separate himself from the people. He lived a simple life, and he used to go down to the masjid and pray. He would even give the khutbah sometimes, he took care of the poor. Right, he was a selfless leader. And then he encouraged education. And he made education free, reading, writing, and arithmetic for every inhabitant, Muslim, Christian, or Jew. Free education. When you reach high school and college, you want to go on, you know, to study the Quran, fine. If you don't, that's okay. He also encouraged trade, skills, agriculture. He had scientists come in from Damascus. They studied North Africa. What are the crops that would grow the best in Spain? So they imported into the country citrus fruits, oranges, grapefruits, lemons, pomegranate, dates, cotton industry. And he encouraged weavers. You see, this is what he's doing. And then one of the biggest things that he did was he brought in water, aqueducts. What does water mean? Tahara, purity, right? Water is the basis of life. So he changed the society, and they had running water everywhere. So by giving opportunity to the masses of the people, right? He won the confidence of the people. He did not spend the money on himself. That's the kind of leader that we need. He was not separated from the people. If you want to ask him a question, he's in the masjid. Didn't separate himself. That's the kind of leader that should be studied today. And one of the interesting things that he did, he built gardens, hospitals, public baths, right? And then there was a big Roman temple that had been changed into a church in Cordoba. That was the capital, Cordoba. And the Muslims were praying there. So many people had started accepting Islam, he bought the church from the Christians. He didn't take it from them. It's a very important point. He purchased the church from the Christians for 100,000 dinars. That's a fabulous amount of money today. Purchased the church. And he turned it into the Grand Mosque and Masjid al-Jami' of Cordoba, which was the largest house of worship in the whole of Western Europe, and we will be looking at it somewhat. And the city of Cordoba, after his time, when other Umayyads came, they built it up by the year 1000. It was the largest city in the world. Look how high they went, right? It was the largest city on earth at the time. Okay? It had 200,000 houses, 600 mosques, 900 public baths, 50 hospitals. Right? The streets were lit for 10 miles in any direction. It took London and Paris 700 years to be like this. Think about this. It took them 700 years to have lighted streets and running water, right? And the facilities they had in this city. 700 years. This is mind-boggling. Did you think anybody knows about this in school, right? Not even in the university. They just call this time period the Dark Ages, when the lights went out, right? But look at how, what the point they reached. And, you know, one of the interesting points about this is that the majority of people who accepted Islam were actually Europeans. If you go by their DNA, it was not a large migration of Arabs or Berbers or Africans or Persians. No. The majority of people who accepted Islam were the Vandals themselves. They became Muslim. And this is a very interesting point. For those of you who want to take this further, then you can download, go on to YouTube. YouTube has captured everything now. There's a piece called When the Moors Ruled Europe. When the Moors Ruled, it's an excellent documentary. You can go right online and see it, right? And they will show you that the people live side by side, Christian, Muslim, and Jew, side by side, no force. And Muslims, just by their positive lifestyle, right, people start to embrace Islam by the thousands. So this is one of the highest points in Islamic history, what the level that they reach here within the society. Not just material things. We had some cities that may have gone higher in material, like Baghdad, but what they reached in terms of their relationship with other people, right? And their hygiene, science, it was an amazing time. Okay, I'm gonna change this now. I want to open up the floor for any questions. Anybody?